Good morning. Welcome to the 10th meeting in 2017 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Please could I remind everyone present to put their mobile phones on silent. Apologies have been received this morning from Richard Lyle, who has been called away on urgent constituency business. The first item on our agenda is the implications of the outcome of the EU referendum for Scotland on agriculture and forestry. It's going to be a round table in discussion, and therefore what I would like to do, if I may, is start off and work that way round the table, i.e. to my right, and ask everyone to say who they are. In the case of MSPs, I would also ask you please to make any declarations of interests in relation to the subject. So I'll start that off, if I may. I'm Edward Mountain. I'm a regional representative for the Highlands and Islands, a convener of the committee, and I declare an interest in that I am a member of a farming partnership.
I'm Gail Ross. I'm the constituency MSP for Caithness, Sutherland and Ross, deputy convener of the committee, interested but no interests.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Good morning. My name is Jonnie Hall. I'm Director of Policy and Member Services with NFU Scotland, and I would also note that I am also currently on secondment with Scottish Government, assisting with their considerations about the implications of leaving the EU on Scottish agriculture.
Rhoda Grant, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Andrew Midgley, I'm Projects and Research Manager at Scottish Land and Estates.
Stuart Stevenson, MSP, Bamshire and Buchan Coast, home of the best beef in the world.
I'm Tom Hind. I'm Chief Strategy Officer at the Agriculture and Horticulture Development Board.
I'm Mike Rummels, MSP for the North East of Scotland.
I'm Pete Ritchie, Director of Nourish Scotland and a small farmer.
Morning. John Finney, Regional MSP for Highlands and Islands.
Good morning, I'm Stephen Thomson. I'm an agricultural economist at Scotland's Rural College, and I also am part of the Centre for Knowledge Exchange and Impact, which is part of the Strategic Research Programme.
Jamie Green, MSP, regional member for the West of Scotland, no interest to declare.
Morning, I'm Stuart Goodall, I'm Chief Executive of Confor, which promotes the forestry and timber sector.
Mary Evans, I'm an MSP for Angus North and Nairns.
Peter Chapman, Regional MSP for the North East. I declare an interest as I am a farmer in the North East, and I am also Rural Economy and Connectivity Shadow Cabinet Secretary.
And we have our clerking team and the official report members on the committee. Now, what I'd like to do is I'd like to conduct this discussion this morning around a series of themes. And each of the members of the committee will lead off with a theme. And I will then look round and try and bring everyone in to the discussion, if I may. Try and catch my eye if you'd like to speak. Do not look away when you are speaking, because if you go on for too long, I also need to slightly rein you back. I hope I won't need to do that. But you can also collect the eye of any of the clerking team or Gail Ross, Deputy Convener, who will make sure that we bring you in. So I think that what we're going to do is move on straight on to the first theme, and that's going to be introduced by John.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thanks to some of you for your written submissions. First theme is about financial support to farming and forestry via CAP, and it's a total of $4.6 billion that will be available between 2014 and 2020. So we'd be keen to hear what you think the benefits of CAP are, and a lot of the submissions have referred to whatever changes take place, the same level of funding should be made available, and if you could say why public money should be used to support farmers, foresters and estates. Yes.
Okay. Who would like to... Johnny?
I'm quite happy to kick that off. I think, obviously, yes, support payments coming into Scottish agriculture in particular have been vitally important for a number of decades now under the CAP, and they remain so, without doubt. The very simple fact is that many, many farms and crofts in Scotland would not be viable in economic terms without that continuing support. Nevertheless, the question really going forward is, do we continue to utilise the same level of support in the same way? And our position would be no. We need the same levels of support, absolutely. But as we go into a non-cap, non-EU world, but with new trading and market opportunities, there is an opportunity to recast agricultural and rural support in Scotland. And I think we should take that opportunity. What we really need to do is focus on the needs of Scottish agriculture rather than necessarily the wants of individual agricultural businesses. Having said all that, clearly direct support payments, which make up the bulk of the payments he talked about, are critical to many, many agricultural businesses, and we would not wish to see the pendulum swing too fast away from direct support payments to actually then threaten some of those businesses. And we're particularly talking about beef and sheep producers on more marginal and upland land who will continue to struggle to make an adequate return purely from the marketplace. Nevertheless, we need to start to refocus support payments so that more agricultural businesses in Scotland are more competitive, more efficient, more market-focused, so that their reliance on support payments diminishes in the long term. So it's not about reducing the quantum of support, but it is about reducing how we spend that support, which is going to be critical to the future of Scottish agriculture, because we are going into a very new operating environment in terms of our trading opportunities and so on. So it's how we manage that change which is critical. The last thing the agricultural industry needs is any form of chaos rather than managed change. And that will be a very, very difficult and arguably turbulent period for Scottish agriculture as we develop new market opportunities. And therefore, the role of support will remain critical. But how that support is played out and how it's used is the key rather than the quantum of money.
Okay, I'm going to bring Andrew in next. And then there's a few people queuing up. And then, John, I'll let you come back in if I may. Andrew.
Thank you, Convener. I think the question started with the benefits, and I think there have been considerable benefits in supporting our farming industries over a long term, and it's been quite successful over the period that it's existed in doing that. When you start to think forward about maintaining the same amount, you get into more difficult territory because you have to start asking questions about why and so on. And I think we would probably want to say that we should maintain support for farms for rural land management businesses. We wouldn't want to see any radical change because if there is a level of dependence at the moment across farming and land management on public support, and if there is radical change, quick change, the impact on those businesses could be quite negative, and it's important that we are relatively cautious. I think there is a need for change, but we need to be cautious about how we go about that change. And that gets into questions about the question about why we should continue to support. And I think from Scottish Land and Estates' position, while we think there should be a continuation of support, we could potentially move to different rationale for why we do that. And so we've set out that we think that support could in the longer term be moved towards rewarding the delivery of public goods, because this is public money being spent on land management and more clearly demonstrating what the public gets in return for that money would be a good thing. There has to be a transition to get there though, because at the moment you have food producing industry, and that's a vitally important industry, and we need to make sure that we don't damage it. So we have to set out a longer term process of how we change the regime to sort of create a more robust rationale for maintaining support to farming and land management.
John, just before I bring you back in, I'd quite like to bring Pete in, if I may, just to your left. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Convener. Very briefly, I think the benefits of CAP have probably been to slow down the period of consolidation in Scottish farming and keep more people on the land, which has benefits in itself. But I'd agree with Jonnie that what's tended to happen is that it's actually reduced innovation, it's reduced market orientation in farming. And what I'm speaking on behalf of Link, which brings together a lot of the different environmental organisations, and we've put this paper together, we argue for retaining the level of investment, as Andrew says, partly because we want to shift the focus towards public money for public goods. We want to see that money going in three directions. One, very much
supporting our farmers to be competitive and market oriented, invest in change, invest in skills, invest in more, just a more market orientation for our farming, improving performance. When you look at the figures, the top quarter of farms are doing okay. It's bringing others up to that level that's really the issue and the challenge for Scottish farming. So a lot of investment in advice and support, and if necessary, loans and grants to facilitate change. But we also see a transition towards agroecology and towards more integrated approach to land management across the piece, with more money going into public goods, whether that's integrating trees with farming, whether it's putting some land into trees, as long as it's the right trees in the right place, or whether it's for more generic rural development, particularly in those areas of Scotland where there's an underdeveloped rural economy and where rural development money, which is where this comes from, could be used effectively. So we do see a transition, but like the other speakers, we recognise that the industry needs time to adapt, and we want to see a planned transition towards some clear public goals, not a shambles.
John, do you want to come back in? Because there's a few people queuing up, and I'm not sure you will have got all the answers. I'd like to bring the other people in as well.
Maybe if I can just add another strand into that, convener, then, please. And that is, at the moment, Scotland gets 17% of the money that the UK gets under the ordinary formula. Post-Brexit, that would be 8%. So it is about how, and quite rightly, everyone's talked about transition, how well-equipped the agricultural and forestry sector is to the inevitable transition that's coming, however it ends up, please.
Stephen, do you want to come in? You indicate you did, and then I'll maybe bring in a couple of the other committee members.
Yeah, just on John's point there about the budget, everybody understands that we punch above our weight in terms of the budget going into CAP in terms of population. If you did it in another way, value of agricultural output, it works out about 11.5%. So there's lots of different ways of cutting this that people aren't... No, we need to think about these going forward. In terms of the benefits, I'm not coming from a lobby group perspective, so I've got no qualms here, and I'm not making a position statement. But it's what we've seen out of the CAP is that we've... And I agree with Pete, is that we've reduced innovation. So the CAP has led to people having a more relaxed time in terms of driving forward innovation, making business developments. However, what it's done is it's made sure that we've had a continuous food production. We have animal welfare standards probably second to none. We have environmental conditions probably second to none. Okay, the Scandinavians might have higher conditions. So we, with the CAP as a carrot, we've managed to deliver a lot of things. Under Pillar 2, we've got the support for the less favoured areas. Okay, that's a very broad definition of what a less favoured area is, but we are maintaining farming activity in these hill and mountain areas that Johnny referred to. And without those, you don't have the grazing regimes. Without the grazing regimes, you don't have the environmental benefits that are derived from land management. So there's a whole host of things there. And the one that people probably don't realise is just how much CAP has made food cheaper in this country. So by supporting the agriculture this way, through a taxpayer, you're actually taking the payment or some of the burden away from the consumer. So you're actually, the rich are paying more proportionally for food production in this country. And one of the other things that probably is a negative on it, on the CAP and what it's delivered, is that it's meant we've probably had people hanging on for longer and longer in terms of intergenerational change, new blood coming into the industry. Land values are constantly going up. That's not all down to CAP. You'll read a lot that the CAP is capitalised into land values, but there's so many other factors at play, including capital gains tax, rollover relief. Those kind of things are driving land price inflation, but it has stymied intergenerational transfer of farms, and it's something that we need to kind of look at going forward. And just finally, I would agree with everyone is that we need to move to a much more outcomes-based approach, rather than the past dictating. We're kind of path dependent in all of this, so the past is dictating what we do in the future. And I think we need to kind of, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to make a change.
Okay, Stephen, I'm going to bring Murray in. I'm interested in your comment that cap made farmers relaxed. I'm not sure that some would agree with that. But Mari, I think you wanted to make
unless
a comment.
Unless others have points specifically on cap, mine is slightly separate to that. So.
Well, there are. Can I bring you in as another moment? Yeah. Stuart, you were next.
It's just a process point. And picky on when Jonnie said he wants to avoid turbulence. And I just wanted to be clear that we've got an idea of how this is all going to happen. Can I suggest that what I'm hearing is that we're in what I would describe as a preparatory phase? In other words, that is the phase that ends at the day X Brexit happens. And until we see what Brexit looks like, we can't commit to anything, but we can prepare. And then immediately at the point of Brexit, we enter a review phase where we check back on all the preparatory and see what we can implement, and then we move to implementation. And I just wanted to test that is a reasonable characterization of the process we want to see, that we can't eliminate the uncertainty until we get to Brexit, because there will be changes, but we can prepare for a range of outcomes, and that kind of, if we look at it in that sense, then without engaging in the policy issues which we'll engage in, is that the way that Johnny in particular was envisaging that we should do things?
Briefly, if you may, Johnny.
I think there's a number of factors going to influence how this process pans out. I don't think we can sit here today and say that we're going to have a certain preparatory phase or a certain review and then implementation phase. There are so many other variables at play here. Clearly, this is going to stray off the current CAP issues and all the rest of it, but what will be fundamental in terms of Scottish agricultural and rural support going forward is the other big negotiating issues of what sort of trade deals are negotiated beyond our withdrawal from the single market. Now, Theresa May has set out a course, the Scottish Government has set out a separate, different course, but the outcome of those discussions, particularly on free trade agreements, will take a very uncertain length of time, and therefore we will require some sort of certainty within that from an agricultural industry point of view, because in my opinion, there is absolutely no guarantee that on day one of Brexit, we will have a market situation which will then allow us to shape a new agricultural support package to make us more competitive in that new market situation. There will be an ongoing need for support through whatever transition or review phase that we have, as your colleague has set out. And therefore, I think we've got to be very, very light on our feet as to how we approach this. I don't think we should fix ourselves to anything here and now in terms of what we want in terms of an agricultural support package, because that will be largely determined by what sort of trade deal outcome the UK and therefore Scotland will get.
I take that point, and I move on to Tom, because maybe you'd like to sort of clarify that on issues relating to the future.
Yeah. So the room, just as with Stephen, I'm not here for a representative organisation, so I'll avoid making the case around the money. However, there were three points that I thought were worth bearing in mind. The first is in relation to what the CAP originally set out to do and measured against the treaty objectives which underpin the Common Agricultural Policy. You could argue that it's been tremendously successful. Now, of course, the debate is whether those objectives under a future UK or Scottish agricultural policy are the right ones. That's one for you guys to discuss. But I think, secondly, one of the key benefits that we tend to ignore is around the fact that the CAP has at least provided a common framework that's linked very closely to the EU's external commercial policy, i.e. trade policy, and also competition policy. And once we remove ourselves from that common framework, there is a debate not only about the kind of common framework that exists in relation to direct support payments, which of course farmers are very, very close to because they see it and they feel it, but also some quite important issues that we tend to ignore in the debate around price and market support policy, the presence of intervention at a European level, some of the competition law exemptions that exist under the CAP, and so on. But the final point I wanted to make was what I think is a really big question, which is the one that Jonnie hinted at there, which is the relationship between a future British and Scottish agricultural policy and the trading relationship that ultimately the UK has not only with the rest of the European Union, which of course is fundamental in terms of our existing markets, but also with other markets as well. We can only anticipate what those scenarios might be, and we can speculate around that. But under most scenarios, we can expect that we'll be seeing an industry that's at risk of more global market exposure, potentially having to compete amongst some of the best in the world in terms of competitiveness, and probably be exposed to greater volatility. And so not only do we have to think about the past and the benefits of the cap in the past and now, but also what kind of policy instruments do we need to help the industry deal with those scenarios that we'll see in the future.
Okay, I'm going to bring Peter in. And Stuart, can I say that you've kept very quiet and below the radar, and I'd quite like to hear your views, as I'm sure the committee would, on forestry, after we've heard just a question from Peter.
Well, it's more a statement than a question, but it's reflecting some of what we've already heard. I mean, we've been discussing this is public money that has to deliver public goods, and I just want to reinforce what Stephen had to say about that. You know, this is a subsidy on food, really. I mean, there's no question about it in my mind. Without this support for agriculture, the high quality food that Scottish agriculture produces wouldn't be able to be produced at the price that it is. It's only the fact that this money is supporting agriculture allows us to trade, you know, in a very difficult marketplace where food has never been so cheap. So you could argue that this subsidy is a subsidy for the general public and that food is cheaper now because of this than it would otherwise be. So that's the first point I would make. And the other thing I would like to say that, 16% of the cap money comes north of the border at the moment. If we went to the Barnett formula, as John was suggesting, then that would come back to about 8%. So that isn't a way forward for supporting agriculture in Scotland, I would argue. We need to keep that rough figure of 16% coming north of the border, so the Barnett formula can't deliver it. I just think that there are opportunities ahead. Obviously, there are opportunities to do this in a different way, and I think the agriculture industry is up for that. But it has to be a general process. It has to be a gradual process. It can't happen overnight. Otherwise, the fallout would be absolutely horrendous in the industry.
Before I bring Stuart in, I noticed that John actually, I think, disagreed with your definition of the 8%. Is that what you want?
No, just for the avoidance of doubt, I was quoting some figures there. I am not commending the Barnett formula for obvious reasons.
Okay, so you're not supporting the Barnett formula. Can I bring Stuart in and then come to you, Mike? I'm trying to work through the list in the order of people that have come up. It's quite difficult, and you'll definitely get in. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. If we're looking for reasons why 17% of the funding should come north of the border as opposed to 8%, then the forestry sector in Scotland is 50% of the forestry sector across the UK, so that justifies significantly additional support. I think the thing to address is why does CAP fund tree planting rather than forestry? Because it doesn't put funding into mature forests. Very little funding goes into forestry generally. It's just the tree planting that receives CAP funding. And the funding there, in effect, is seeking to tackle market failure, because we would argue that if CAP didn't exist, if there wasn't a funding regime supporting agriculture, there'd be an awful lot more forestry in Scotland. It's not just because of the benefits, answering the why question, in terms of climate change mitigation, flooding mitigation, in terms of contribution to the rural economy. We know that from studies carried out by SEC that forestry, compared to sheep farming in uplands, delivers three times as much economic return to the sheep farmer and puts twice as much money into the local economy. So there's a lot of good reasons for supporting it. And when those payments are made, part of it is a payment for establishing the forest, but then part of it's a payment to incentivize a farmer to move out of agricultural on that land. And I think that flags up the opportunity for us as we move to a post-CAP situation in Scotland, is how can we come up with integrated rural policy which allows landowners to look at forestry as an integrated opportunity in farming, which I'm happy to say more about at the moment. But at the moment, I'd just like to say, I think there's a huge opportunity there that we need to consider as part of this discussion.
Mike,
The key issue, from what I can see of this whole theme, is about money, and it's about structures, and structures comes first rather than money. Under the Scotland Act, as we're all aware, agriculture and forestry are not reserved, they are devolved. So under the current regime, under the legal situation, when this these mechanisms are repatriated from the European Union, they will come to Scotland. And if that happens in that way, then like everything else in the Barnett formula, it will come under the Barnett formula. But I am aware that the UK government is in discussions with the devolved administrations to say that perhaps there should be an agreement amongst the devolved administrations and the UK government that will have a separate overarching function here. So really what I'm asking our witnesses is, which do you prefer? Do you prefer a structure which the devolved administrations and the UK government can work together on a new scheme for these repatriated funds? Or do you feel that the repatriated funds under the Scotland Act should simply come back to Scotland and we receive that funds in the normal way? I'm very interested to find out what our witnesses' views are.
Stephen, do you want to start that off, and then I'll try and work round the table here because I see hands going up everywhere.
Yeah, I suppose the real issue here is, do we want to create internal, and I mean internal UK trade issues? If the framework, so the current CAP framework's decided at EU, we then buy into it, and there's quite a lot of flexibility in that framework, the current framework. If we basically had four individual schemes or operations of CAP that aren't particularly related, so if Scotland has its own CAP mechanisms, England's got its own, we could very quickly end up with a trade distortion between our biggest trade partner, which is south of the border. We're already seeing it partially with the existing CAP, in that the payment rates per hectare for uplands in England is much higher than it is in Scotland. But of course, we've got a headage payment on cattle. There's a headage payment on ewe hogs in some of the rough grazing areas. So there's some real difficulties that we would face if we controlled our own destiny, to say where CAP monies went. So I think a framework where all the devolved administrations and the Westminster government come together to come up with a flexible enough package that allows us to do our own things within that package is probably the best solution. Because otherwise we are going to end up with internal trade issues.
Okay, I'm going to go to Jonnie, and then I'm going to like to bring Rhoda in before I come to Andrew, if I may.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up on certainly the question that's been raised, and then one or two of the points that Stephen made. I think in terms of funding, the funding settlement is critical in many ways. We see this relatively simply, though, from the other question, if you like, of how you devolve or otherwise the settlement on support. The funding settlement is all about the renationalisation of the CAP funding that the UK would have got, and that will go back to the UK government. So the budget responsibility will still rest with the UK government, in my view. Therefore, it's vital that Scotland makes the case to retain, at very least, the same share of that existing budget. Not the same share of a declining budget. If the UK Treasury seeks to reduce the amount it spends on agriculture compared to what the UK currently receives from the CAP, but it's the same share of the existing quantum. So I think Mr. Finney referred to earlier about 4.5 billion coming into Scottish agriculture and the rural sector over the 2014 to 2020 period. We want to see that same commitment from the UK Treasury, in effect, coming into Scotland. But then the question is about the powers, if you like, about the choices over how you then spend that money. And that's this issue, and it is a very important issue that we're discussing all the time, whether you go for a UK approach or a Scottish, Northern Irish, English and Welsh approach in terms of different agricultural and rural policies. As Mr. Rumbles quite rightly said, you know, we've had devolved agricultural responsibilities since 1998, and by and large, that's worked very, very well in Scotland's interests. It does today. Under the CAP, what Scotland does is different from England, Wales, and Northern Ireland. In fact, all four corners of the UK do things differently under a common agricultural policy, but we operate to the same standards in terms of animal welfare, environment, plant protection products, and so on. So there's those common standards which allows that intra-UK trade that Stephen referred to, but also allows intra-EU trade currently. So what we want to see happen, in our view, it's very clear that the devolution settlement gives Scottish ministers the discretion to set a policy that is appropriate for Scotland's needs. And Scotland's needs are very different from the rest of the UK. The profile of Scottish agriculture is significantly different from other parts of the United Kingdom. We do everything. It's very, very diverse. Soft fruit production, seed potato production, cereals, fattening beef, lamb, milk, everything you can possibly think of, moving up the hill to very extensive hill sheep grazing. So fitting an agricultural policy to that and ensuring that each sector and each business has an opportunity to move forward is extremely difficult. But a one-size-fits-all UK policy would not work. It would not be in Scotland's interests. So what we're looking for is each of the devolved to develop their own approaches, but then within that, you'd have to have some sort of common framework that allows for the intra-UK issues to be addressed, such as animal health and welfare standards and pesticides and all these other bits and pieces that allow this broad brush baseline standard to enable trade to continue. So it's definitely not, and I think in our paper I refer to a DEFRA-centric one-size-fits-all. That's not, that would not be in the interest of Scottish agriculture, and I think you'll find that similar views held in Wales and Northern Ireland. But it is vitally important that we also do not do something which is so perpendicular from the rest of the United Kingdom, or indeed the rest of Europe or anywhere else, that then thwarts our efforts to then trade.
I'm going to stop you there, and I'm going to gently remind you, Jonnie, to look this way occasionally, just so we can...
I can assure you, Convener, I deliberately looked at the questioner in order to avoid your...
and you won't escape that in future. Rhoda, you wanted to come in.
Just on that point, because obviously our trade agreements will create the overall parameters of how we operate after Brexit. So there will be an overarching UK policy to an extent, because that will be framed by the trade agreements we have, especially with the EU. So in a way, that continues that process that gives, but surely within that, we can then have devolved administrations making the decisions that, I suppose, support their own particular circumstances within the parameters of the trade deals that are set up.
Okay. Andrew, do you want to comment on that?
Yes, I mean, I think that's right. Our starting point in answer to the original question, our starting point was, well, where are we at the moment? In terms of the cap, we have the overarching envelope that provides the context of the decisions that we then make. So we have the power to tailor within that overarching envelope provided by the CAP. And that gives us the benefits in terms of being able to trade within the EU and the benefits of the trade relationships of the EU with other countries. And we also get the benefit in terms of the support that comes through the Common Agricultural Policy. So the CAP works in a way where there's an overarching framework and then the ability to tailor under that. And we our starting point was probably that we would support a UK sort of framework that replicated that arrangement because it enabled, it wouldn't, the context, that overarching envelope would provide the stability that would allow and facilitate trade within the UK, and so there wouldn't be any distortions in that way. And key part of that is that Scotland's powers would stay the same in terms of being able to tailor the policy as it does now. We wouldn't see a huge difference in there. The difficulty comes in that when powers in that sort of overarching envelope way, if they were to do this, were to move from Brussels to London, we hit the sort of devolution problem about the degree to which Westminster determines that envelope. And for us, we would be very keen that, we'd be more than very keen, we think it would absolute requirement that any overarching policy had to be jointly developed and equally developed so that we didn't have some situation where that overarching envelope of policy was actually determined for us. We had to be actually at the table. And that actually speaks to other points that were made earlier about preparation, about where we are at the moment. We need to know what we want so that we can be helping sort of develop that policy now, because it will be taking shape where people start to think now about future support structures, whether we should be moving, the degree to which we should have direct support, and so on. So we collectively, Scottish Government, need to be developing quite sophisticated ideas about what our future should look like, because that will determine the sorts of arguments that we make as we develop policy today.
Okay, before I bring you in, Pete, Stuart's got a relevant question there, I think, which, if it's a quick one.
It's a quick question, whether the answer is remains to be seen. There are bodies already in existence. The British Waterways Board was an example. The appointment of members to the Climate Change Committee is another, that involve all the administrations, UK and the four devolved administrations, and require unanimity of view. And I just wonder whether, if there were an overarching framework, it would be thought to be reasonable that it would require a unanimity of view as to what the overarching framework might be and what the pros and cons of that approach, rather than ultimately being something that Westminster decides regardless of the views of devolved administrations.
So a shared approach. Andrew, do you want to answer that quickly, because you developed that, and then I'd like to go over to Pete, if I may.
I think we would probably need something like that in order to be able to sign up to it. But if we think about what we'd be talking about, what the CAP does at the moment, it sets out the broad principles that that the policy is trying to achieve, and those are overarching objectives that. I suspect, actually, we would have a great deal of agreement about in terms of wanting to support food production, support land management, enhance environmental outcomes, and so on. So I think we would probably be moving in the direction where we'd be have the same objectives, where we'd start to get into more difficult conversations are on the structures that you might put in place to help deliver those things. But that's where the devolved power comes in, that you get the ability to tailor. So the actual overarching agreement could be something potentially that there's more agreement on than we might think.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Pete now. Can I just say that we are on the first theme? There are nine of them, and I've let this one run on a wee bit because I think it's the linchpin for all of it. So I will have to sort of ask you all to give shortish answers without diluting what you're saying. Sorry, Pete.
Okay, so very briefly, yes, we would agree you need a consensual framework, and we'd probably argue that the Republic of Ireland should be involved in some of those conversations too, because their industry is so integrated in many ways. But just to make a more general point, there have been lots of criticism of the Common Agricultural Policy, not just in its operation, but as a policy framework, where people have said, we don't just need an agricultural policy, we need a land use policy for Europe, we need a food policy for Europe. Agriculture is too narrow a container for a policy. And certainly in Scotland, if you look at the National Performance Framework and our existing policy architecture, we have a policy on land use, we have a land use strategy, we have policies on climate change, we have sort of implicit policies around rural development in terms of subsidising some of the essential services in rural areas. And we have a food policy, particularly expressed in Recipe for Success and a Good Food Nation. And in a sense, agriculture policy isn't a domain on its own, and we should make sure that it's understood as an integral part of those other policy frameworks and not separate from. So our concern would be not that we, you know, don't develop our autonomous approach to this in Scotland,
and we need to develop our policy goals for those areas about integrated land use, about food, and about rural development.
I'm going to stop you there, because integrated land use, which we're going to come on to as a specific theme, I'm sure you can develop that. And I think the committee understands what you're saying, but I'd like to save that bit that you're rightly going to bring up
just
a little
briefly,
bit later.
Let's not transpose the architecture of the common agricultural policy into a Scottish agricultural policy.
Okay. Stuart, I think you wanted to say something briefly before we moved on.
Yeah, just very quickly. In terms of forestry, my feeling is the more detail that's agreed at the UK level, the less opportunity there will be for devolved administrations to operate flexibly, to be inclusive, to look at things like forestry. So I think better to have a high level of detail. And also, quite practically speaking, we lack confidence in the UK government's ability to deliver on forestry. We've had an EFRA committee report yesterday, which is pretty damning of their performance on forestry, whereas in Scotland, with cross-party support, it's been far more successful.
Okay, we'll not dwell on targets then at that stage. So I'm going to ask John now to move on to the next theme.
Sorry, I did have a question earlier, but it was just it was a separate point to what's been discussed. And a quick question, really, because I think that just talking about the financial support to farming and forestry, but also in terms of the financial support to the wider rural economy of Scotland. I mean, for example, in my constituency, LEADER funding is of huge importance to us. It's worth £2.8 million to South Aberdeenshire, £2.7 million to Angus. So it was just to get your opinions on what sort of funding you think there should be available to the wider rural communities as well, because I think that's a vital aspect of what we're going to be looking at here.
Gosh, that's a whole different theme. No, well, you're right, it doesn't slip in, but it's an important thing. Johnny, if...
Convener, I think the point you make is very, very important indeed. It's not just about where the money is spent, but what then happens to that money. And I would make a very clear point about the direct support payments of Pillar 1 of the CAP that come into Scotland. Right now, Scottish agriculture and crofting receives in the order of about £500 million per year. In CAP payments, but agriculture and farming and crofting in Scotland spends £2.7 billion per year on all sorts of costs related to activities in terms of farming the land. And therefore, we might well receive £500 million, but we spend £2.7 billion, five and a half times that amount, and that is driving the rural economy. And that is a very, very important point. And the same is true of other fundings. You've referred to LEADER, and there's lots of other elements of Pillar 2, which again generate incomes and jobs and all sorts of other things downstream, upstream, and really underpin so much that goes on in our rural communities. It's not just the headline figure that we should look at. It's what happens to it.
I don't think anyone's going to dispute with anyone on the importance of rural funding. And I'm sorry, we could take this on, and there are still people waiting to come in. I apologise to them. I want to move on to John with his next theme, please.
OK. Well, having not decided where we're going, we still need to decide how we're going to get there. And the theme is headed up, untangling domestic policy from EU legislation. But I think what I'm particularly interested in is the Great Repeal Bill, which we have been promised. Now, as I understand it, that will repeal the European Communities Act, and the idea is to incorporate or transpose European law into domestic law. But it's just to think, you know, how are we actually going to get there? Because I think, Pete, if I heard you correctly, you just said that we didn't want to transpose the CAP straight in here. Now, the question then would be, do we need new legislation, therefore? In which case the new legislation presumably has to be in place for the 1st of April 2019, which is 2 years next weekend. So we really need to start that legislation now. So I just wonder if that's what you're saying. I noticed what the NFUS says in, I think, your last paragraph about regulations and standards, and kind of suggesting that we might actually want to stick with the EU standards in many cases and regulations, because then we could export more easily. So in that case, you could just say, well, even though we're out of the EU, we will still do all that the European Commission tells us to do, would be another extreme. That would be nice and simple, but I'm not sure it's what everyone wants. So I'm just kind of, can we explore that area?
Would you like to come in, Pete, on that?
Briefly, yes. I mean, I think everybody would agree that if we want to trade within the EU, we're going to mirror to a large extent all the EU regulations that govern trade. So any trade agreement will involve regulatory compatibility. So to that extent, not much will change. I honestly don't know whether we need new legislation to administer elements of a devolved policy in Scotland. I'm not sure we do. At the moment, we're still, the Agriculture Acts from 1947 onwards, I think, are still on the statute book, which permit ministers to do lots of things in terms of supporting agriculture if they choose to do so. And I'm not sure what the status of the Treaty of Rome is after the Great Repeal Bill, but that's the treaty which governs the Common Agricultural Policy.
And so, I mean, one option is obviously to give government ministers, be that Scottish or UK, huge powers to basically do anything they want. Because, I mean, the regulations from Europe would not automatically come through here, so we'll have to say they will automatically come through, or we have to give the ministers the power to bring in equivalent ones. Yeah.
My understanding, there are four defining regulations which define the Common Agricultural Policy, and my guess is those might be transposed. That doesn't transpose all the detail of administration, and certainly by April 2019, we won't be in a position to know what administrative detail we want. But Jonnie will probably have more detail on that issue.
I'm going to bring in Stuart now, and then Tom, if I may, Stuart.
Thank you very much. Again, it's a process point, Convener. In that it's estimated, I think it's probably speculated, perhaps even rather than estimated, that there may be as many as 10,000 pieces of secondary legislation required at Westminster across all policy areas related to Brexit. And clearly quite a lot of them will touch on this policy area. And I'm just concerned that where negative instruments, in other words, those that don't require direct approval by Parliament, at Westminster, there is no scrutiny process of any kind whatsoever, as my colleague Alison Foulis has just found this week in relation to, I won't go into the details, they're well known. Whereas here, even negative instruments go to two committees as a minimum here, and at least there is an opportunity, taken only occasionally, to be fair, to properly scrutinise. And I just wonder if people in this room would care to express an opinion. I'm open to any answer. I think if Westminster were to say, under these circumstances, we're going to put a formal process, perhaps similar or learning from our one, into place, then we might be safe from an inadequately drafted negative instrument that had enormous consequences that really escaped parliamentary scrutiny. I just wondered how people felt about that, because we're in quite difficult process territory, it seems to me.
Tom, do you want to come back on that short question?
Yes, thanks, Convener.
Sorry, Stuart.
I'd love to say that I had an answer to that, but one, I'm not a lawyer, and two, I'm not an expert in parliamentary process, either in Scotland or in Westminster either. There were two points that I did want to make, though. I think the first is the status of agriculture within the Great Repeal Bill. Jonnie may or may not be able to confirm my understanding, but my understanding initially in relation to the Great Repeal Bill is that it will not seek to transpose the CAP into domestic legislation, hence agricultural policy remains in a bit of a void as to how that will be handled in terms of how it then gets transposed into domestic legislation. The second point is more of a practical one, and that's simply about capacity. Across governments in Scotland and Westminster, we know that the capacity to make policy under a business as usual scenario has been quite significantly reduced as a consequence of government austerity, reductions in resource expenditure, etc. And the requirement to deal not only with business as usual in making, setting policy and developing legislation compounded by Brexit is vast. And therefore it strikes me not only are there certain desirable elements of maintaining the same legislative and regulatory framework after Brexit as there are now in areas like Johnny hinted at earlier in relation to animal welfare, food standards, crop protection, etc., but also it may well be a practical necessity from the point of view of making new policy and legislation.
Okay, maybe that's a point to bring in Johnny Hall, and then I'm going to come to you, Andrew, if I may.
Yeah, I'll try and be brief on this. I think Pete identified that there are four main EU regulations which govern the CAP. Behind that, there are also delegated acts, and then there are implementing acts. And then behind that again, there are Scottish statutory instruments which then enable Scottish government to make payments and to carry out inspections and do various processes. So there's a whole raft or layers of legislation which will have to be teased out very, very, very carefully indeed. But I would say that whilst that is a primary concern, I would say there is a whole host, as Tom's just referred, or a previous speaker just referred to, about the whole range of possible other pieces of legislation, which will have to be, in my view, cut and paste on day one. And only over time, with the right capacity, can we then start to see whether they are fit for purpose for Scottish or UK circumstances. If you think about nitrates directive, birds directive, habitats directive, also all the animal health and welfare, traceability legislation, food and feed hygiene regulations, the list is endless, and they all have an impact on agriculture, crofting, land management per se, and various other things. So we will have to, I think, from day one, basically say, draw a line in the sand. We have this EU legislation. We will continue to operate under that EU legislation, but we will slowly but surely try and modify it to the point where we want to remove things that are either inappropriate or we can change and still operate to a standard that still allows us to trade.
Okay. Could I just press you on a point there? I mean, are you saying then that you would kind of stop the EU input on the 1st of April 2019 and then we'd... then anything new we would just do ourselves and we would change the existing system gradually over time? Or are you saying that even after the 1st of April 2019 you would continue to feed in, you would accept feed in from the European level?
Again, I think that is partly unanswerable at the moment because we still don't know what sort of trading arrangements we might negotiate with Europe or anywhere else. And if one of the terms and conditions of the trading agreement is that we maintain a standard that Europe wants on, let's say, use of plant protection products, pesticides, for example, then I think we will have to then... So in some ways, the influence of Europe will not go away if we want to trade with them. So, but I do think there is clearly an opportunity under CAP regulation and all the rules surrounding that to actually say, well, we can still meet a standard on things like traceability, inspection, verification, all these sorts of things, without necessarily being tied up by what we consider today, or many consider today, to be over bureaucratic red tape.
Okay. Andrew, cut and paste European regulations, is that what you're going to suggest?
I think it's almost impossible to overstate the size of the task that we face. In terms of regulation and legislation, just that task alone is huge. And for the benefit of stability across land-based businesses, I think it's really important that people know where they stand. So we have suggested that actually we do kind of roll over lots of legislation and then, so in a similar way to as Johnny was saying, and then subsequently tweak, tailor, remove the bits that we think need to be changed. But I have to reinforce Tom's point about capacity. The size of the task is so great in terms of the resource that will be required to go through the legislation. And we've already started talking about future policy. That in itself requires input and government resources in terms of staff time and so on. It's not clear to me at all that the Scottish Government has the resources to manage the task.
Okay. Stephen, do you want to come in?
I would kind of agree with everyone here in terms of, as particularly Johnny's point, the wider regulatory sort of rules that exist within the EU. Having spent about 2.5 years of my life with Brian Pack looking at red tape in agriculture, it drove me insane at times looking at all these different regulations, and particularly the sort of approaches. So DG Agri, is in their interpretation of tagging, which is a DG Sanko rule, drive the penalties that we get. But then that's also driven by the Scottish Government's interpretation of DG Agri's rules. So there's a real mix in here in play.
But I think we're going to have to just basically take on all those regulations, because otherwise we just, as Andrew said and Johnny said, we don't have that capacity. It's not there. We cannot conceivably implement rules for all these areas that are covered within 2-3 years. We have to adopt these rules and then weed out the ones that we think are unfit for purpose, where there's issues. But we also have to look at how we're implementing those rules internally, because some of it, we came across it in the review, was when you start reading the regulation, you're thinking, why are we doing it this way? And it's because of somebody's interpretation that that's what they are. And that's driven by the fear culture of audit. And the fear culture of audit has driven us into some of the implementation rules that farmers and land managers are faced with. So there's a whole series of activities that need to be done. And then coming back to Andrew's point, and that's just before we even start considering the next ag policy that we have.
Okay, well, that's probably the perfect point to move on to the next theme, which Roger's going to take us to.
Yes, it's about future policy, and I think people have big shopping lists as to what they think the future Scottish agriculture policy should be. And rather than asking for a big shopping list, I guess I'm asking for what basic principles should underpin it. You know, what is the most important issue that we need to try and replicate going forward, or indeed maybe not replicate, maybe get rid of, to make a big difference.
Okay, everyone's desperately making notes. Stuart, you've avoided answering first at any stage, so we might bring you in first just to see if you've got a list.
Thank you, Gavina. Going last gives me time to collect my thoughts. One quick thing, just on the previous point, I would say there's a huge issue around interpretation of legislation. There's a big grey area. We've got an example just now where in the sawmilling sector, tens of thousands of pounds are being spent to meet an EU requirement, new legislation and licensing to do with wood treatment. And we look across the rest of EU, and virtually no other country is doing anything, even though they all operate exactly the same systems. And what we're told by SEPA is that that's because they're not interpreting the legislation correctly. So I think there's a huge issue around there. In terms of future policy, how we would like it to look, I think I could encapsulate it by saying we would like a common countryside policy rather than a common agricultural policy. We think when we leave the EU, whatever arrangement there is that takes place, and we leave the common agricultural policy, there's no need for us to carry on just folding everything forward, as has already been said. We see that forestry is a sector that's grown hugely over the last 30 years in Scotland, to now become, in many ways, another part of a fundamental part of the rural economy. So picking up Johnny's point about support and contribution, the forestry sector receives about £36 million. That's almost all for planting, and none of it's for managed forestry, but it contributes £1 billion to the economy and rising. But there are opportunities to develop that. So point about sort of leader and support diversification. I think what we need is an opportunity to look at how do we have sustainable, successful rural areas, delivering for the environment, but delivering for local economies, but also delivering for society as a whole. And therefore, we would like to see a policy approach which is based around sustainable development, where we truly are trying to see how do we balance all the different interests of economy and environment and society. And in forestry, we've gone through that process 20, 25 years ago in response to huge pressure around the forestry that was planted in the last century and how we were managing a forest. So we've developed detailed standards with environmental organizations, societal organizations, access organizations, and we would like to see that principle shared more widely. Recognizing, however, just to conclude, that Johnny and others have said that it doesn't make sense on 2019, 2020 to suddenly say everything changes and it's now a completely new landscape. But we would like to see a process of transforming as quickly as we can from a very narrow approach to supporting rural areas, principally focused around agriculture, to one which is focused more widely and based on sustainable development principles.
Okay. Jonnie, do you want to...
I think I probably mentioned it earlier on, or certainly made reference to it. I mean, going forward, we would like to see a policy that leaves farming and crofting less, obviously less reliant on direct support payments and much more focused on returns from the market, whatever their market might be. And also, obviously, then to deliver on a number of environmental objectives as well. Now, moving this tanker, super tanker of the CAP, and actually turning it around is really going to be quite a difficult task in doing that. I think, as I also mentioned earlier, that it's going to be about managing the change. If we suddenly switch off the CAP as we currently know it and move to something that where we might want to be at some point in the future, then there might be such an upheaval in the process that it would be extremely damaging, not only to agriculture and food production, but to many rural areas and so on. So in broad principle terms, my shopping list, if you like, would be that we still will require some sort of income stabilisation tool for many, many sectors in Scottish agriculture, particularly the red meat sector, to cushion against market volatility and to provide some sort of basic income support, where we know that the market returns are still not covering costs. I think there's still a very, very strong case in Scotland to retain a less favoured area support element too. It is quite clear that in significant areas of Scotland that agriculture will always struggle to generate enough income from the land to cover the costs, but the benefits of retaining those grazing systems, I think Stephen referred to earlier, are not just about food production. They're about people keeping people in remote communities and delivering grazing management and all the benefits that come with that. But I think we do need to deliberately start to turn focus onto more support in terms of investment and innovation in building resilience, building business resilience, allowing businesses to become more competitive, to embrace new trading and new market opportunities. And it's that switch from farming for support payments, which I think an awful lot of individual businesses have done for far too long, to farming for the market, which is vital. And above all, and I mean this absolutely, we must build in to all of this better delivery on environmental and other public good aspects of what farming and crofting are all about. Because if we don't put those front and centre, then the case for public support is significantly diminished. Scottish agriculture as a primary land use has significant responsibilities in delivering on biodiversity, water quality and climate change. And I think we have an opportunity to put those things rather than a bolt-on which becomes a bureaucratic responsibility, which have certainly been the case with things like the CAP's greening rules, which were just dropped on Scotland and don't really fit Scottish circumstances and have just become another cross-compliance issue, a tripwire, if you like. We need to build in environmental delivery as part of what we do and why farmers and crofters continue to get support.
Okay, Andrew, just before I bring you in, I think, in fact, it was Tom, no, it's not Andrew, just before I bring you in, as a convener, you don't always get a chance to ask all the questions you'd like, but here's my chance to ask a question, is that I would like, if possible, for you to build into your answers how we are going to convince farmers that they're going to get paid value for money for what they produce and not are going to have to rely on subsidies to make up the difference in the shortfall between what they receive at the farm gate from the people who are buying the produce. For example, barley farmers may be producing barley at £130 a tonne, knowing it costs £130 a tonne, and the maltsters will offer them £130 a tonne, knowing that the subsidy will make up the difference. That obviously doesn't seem right, and I would like to know how, when we're changing agricultural policy, we're going to convince people to pay a proper price. And on that note, Tom, having had my question, I'll bring you in with your answer.
Thank you, Convener. That wasn't quite the question I prepared for, but I'm prepared to have a stab at it at the end of this. The point I did want to make is we're not a trade association, so I don't come with an exhaustive shopping list. But I will say one thing. In order to unlock global opportunities, and perhaps linking in with your question, Convener, in order to compete in a marketplace which can at times be brutal, the only sure way of enabling farmers and growers to do that is to grow productivity, by which I mean their ability to convert inputs into outputs. And unfortunately, we have a systemic challenge across UK and Scottish agriculture that productivity growth is at best flat. So we absolutely have to focus our future policy on growing agricultural productivity. Now, we can spend a lot of time trying to diagnose the reasons for that, and I think it's important that we do really understand the productivity challenge and why we have such a big problem. But to my mind, it's down to three things. It's down to the rate at which innovation is taken up on farm, it's about knowledge exchange and knowledge transfer, and it's about skills.
Okay. Andrew, would you like to come in? And then, Peter, I think you're wanting to come in, so we'll take Andrew next.
Thank you. In answer to the original question, in broad terms, I echo some of what Stuart said in terms of integrated land management. The land, as a resource, delivers a great deal to society. Obviously, of primary importance in lots of ways, food, but it also produces timber, but also lots of services and in terms of environmental services, climate change mitigation, water quality, and so on. You know, I think as an organisation, we're keen that any future policy approaches land management in an integrated way. Thinking of it within that, what's important to Scottish Land and Estates is that we come up with the strongest justification for supporting land managers, given the context that we're in terms of sort of austerity, in terms of threatened budgets, in terms of pressure on public services. We have to come up with the strongest possible justification for why the public should invest money in land management. And from our point of view, the strongest argument is around delivering things to society that society needs, and the strongest argument there is around public goods. That, though, is our long-term sort of objective. We do believe that we do have to face the challenges of where we are now, and that comes to the points that have already been raised. So the first one there is about the problems around profitability and productivity, and so I've also written down things around innovation, knowledge exchange, diversification, and so on. And in question about the farmers getting value, I mean, the thing that immediately comes to mind again is cooperation in terms of trying to get greater market power in the marketplace. It's not easy, I know, and people already cooperate, but there could be a role for government to help in terms of enhancing profitability and productivity, but also help in terms of getting farmers in a better place so they can operate in the market. As well as the profitability productivity point, we also think that there will be an ongoing requirement to prevent, in some places, land abandonment where that could be a potential challenge. So at the moment, the LFA is designed, it provides funding in order to do that, but there are question marks around the LFA in terms of the area that it covers, in terms of the nature of support, and that probably needs to be looked at again. But there are large areas where farming in particular is quite challenging, but we need that farming to continue because it delivers a wide range of things, not to society in terms of rural communities and environment. So going forward, there's a range of things.
Okay. I think, Pete, is that right? Pete, yes, you were next, yeah.
That's great. And I don't want to repeat the other things people have said about improving productivity. It's clear, but particularly it seems to us that in the red meat sector, we could be doing a lot more with the whole supply chain. And your point about malting barley, similarly, looking at the whole supply chain and looking at where we can improve synergy within that and a fair return to farmers. But there's not all that much knowledge, certainly in the red meat supply chain, that's transferred. There's also a huge range of performance. And I do think we have to address that and recognize the fact that the top performers are doing okay, in fact, doing very well in global terms. So let's celebrate that, but recognize we've got a very long tail to deal with too. But we want to see support for the food industry as it were, part of a broader good food nation approach to food production and consumption, and looking at the whole issue about how do we produce food that's inevitably going to be premium, provenance, quality,
in the food and drink sort of approach, but that we can make it affordable to people across Scotland, including people on low incomes. We do need a food policy that, if one of the central public goods of our farming system is food production, we need to make sure that public good is shared among everybody in Scotland. So we need a more sophisticated approach to food policy that looks at consumption as well as production, and that builds in support. We don't need support at the moment for horticulture and soft fruit. Those sectors are doing very well without CAP support, but we do need to recognise that they can make a major contribution to Scotland's health, because we actually need to eat more fruit, soft fruit, and more vegetables. You know, it's arguable that some of the other things we produce, which are wonderful, we need to eat or drink so much more of. So a cross-cutting food policy we think is important. Agree with Andrew entirely, we need an integrated land use approach. And we'd like to see, I think, much more regionalised land use frameworks, getting down into what public goods in this region or this catchment area are most important, and having democratic engagement in that.
You're onto the integrated land use. It's a very big topic, and it's going to come up in a separate thing.
Okay, that's the shopping list. Other people have just talked about integrated land use. I'm saying the only point I'm adding to that is that we'd like to see some sort of democratic engagement in that to identify the priorities locally or regionally for public goods. Because they'll differ in different areas. And picking up Mary's point earlier, you know, we also want to see a strong rural development approach that's targeted on the more deprived rural areas, and recognising that population maintenance in rural areas is really important, but it's not all down to farming. We've seen population increases in remote Scotland, not as a result of new farming enterprises, but as a result of lots of other different industries.
Okay, before I bring Stephen in, I'd like to just bring Peter in, if I may.
Thanks to convener. It's really just to highlight the point you've made yourself, really. It's how we can get the marketplace to work better for us as food producers. You know, Scotland Food and Drink's worth £14.5 billion, and it's seen as a huge success story. But the primary producers, the guys right at the end of the chain, they don't seem to see much benefit from that. How can we get the marketplace to work better for us? Do we need a stronger supermarket ombudsman? Our problem as producers, we're all very small businesses, and we trade with very large and powerful businesses. And how can we get a bit more fairness into the marketplace so that we as primary producers can share a bit better in this £14.5 billion food, Scotland Food and Drink, which is a success story?
Stephen in on that, and then maybe I'll look round. Do you want to come in, John, afterwards?
Yeah, I'll just sit and smile.
Okay.
I'll try and be as brief as possible. In our Rural Scotland and Focus report recently, we kind of suggested that you need to think about what our overall rural policy or rural development objectives are, to which agriculture ties in. Agriculture isn't always all of rural development. There's an awful lot of other business that goes ahead. And we need an overarching rural policy before we actually consider what we do with ag policy, because agriculture fits in with that. And as Jonnie says, it's incredibly important in terms of the amount of expenditure that farmers have in the wider economy, not always rural actually, but they spend an awful lot. In terms of the basic principles, I think everybody, and no matter where you read it, in terms of the EU, CAP is going to go this way. They're talking about becoming much more outcomes focused in terms of delivering for environment and delivering for climate change. Delivering for smallholders is the way CAP looks to be going, giving a bigger chunk of money to smallholders because of the role they play in maintaining the countryside and maintaining populations in some remote areas. So going to that outcomes-based approach to make the farming sector or ag policy more justifiable to the taxpayer, that is a fundamental challenge that we are going to have in the UK, because EU currently dictate where the money goes. They decide how much CAP money comes into all the countries. They dictate that agriculture is important. We, under Brexit, are going to have to justify to the taxpayer why should we continue to support agriculture. So making sure that those outcomes are absolutely explicit within our policy is essential. It is important that we have a more resilient sector. Some of the stuff that we've been doing shows that within the farming sector, there's a lot of non-viable businesses. There's an awful lot of evidence that suggests that hill farmers aren't reinvesting in their businesses, which means that buildings, the condition of buildings, etc., are becoming poorer. Pete is absolutely right. We've got some real champions in terms of agriculture in this country. Some of the top producers are real go-setters. They're agribusiness. And I'm not convinced that we are ever going to pull this tail that everybody keeps talking forward. If you look at the statistics, 20% of the holdings in Scotland, or the people with sheep, control 80% of the sheep. 20% of the holdings with beef control 80% of the beef. 20% of the cereal holdings control 80% of the cereals. So if you're talking about food production, then you're focusing on 20% of the holdings largely. If you're talking about a wider agricultural policy that supports farmers, crofters, smallholders, then you sometimes have to think of different objectives. And perhaps we need to start thinking about what we actually want out of agricultural policy. Coming back to this element that you mentioned about how do we get more value for money for the farmer or more of the retail value. I think working with the organisations like SAOS is absolutely essential. We need more cooperation. We've shown that some of the cooperatives that work in Scotland have shown that by a cooperation you can actually make significant gains in terms of the profitability to your sector. I'm always amazed that with Scottish whisky, everyone talks about Scottish food and drink and the value to the economy, of course, most of that's to do with whisky. Why isn't there a concordant of agreement between the barley producers of Scotland and the whisky sector that they will, where possible, try and make sure that they source Scottish barley? I mean, those kind of things, those approaches, they're not hugely innovative, but we need collective action, and getting that collective action is difficult because we are, as a sector, agriculture has been pretty poor at coming together, particularly in the sort of the mainstream agriculture, in the sort of the pig sector, the poultry sector, and the fruit sector, the horticulture sector, which have historically not been supported. You've seen much more cooperation.
Thank you very much, Tom. I'm going to let you come in very briefly, if I may, because those of you that will have noted, we're still on theme three, and we've got a long way to go. But it is interesting. So, Tom, if you can
I'll do my best convener. I guess I've got the experience of having worked for a farming organisation and indeed for a major retailer as well. So I've seen different ends of the supply chain. In my view, you can't book the market. And if you're supplying a relatively undifferentiated, commoditised raw material, then you have to accept that you're competing on the basis of cost. There are two elements to this. One, can you compete on cost? And in some sectors of British and Scottish agriculture, we can. Dairy being one example, where in European terms we have some of the most efficient dairy farmers in the European Union. We talked about fruit and vegetables earlier. But in other sectors, the opportunity lies in differentiating and creating value. There will always be an existential challenge about how do you get the value down from one end of the supply chain to the other. I won't go over the arguments about cooperation, but I will bring Pete's point in earlier about value chains. How can we ensure that we've got the best value chains that eliminate waste and strip out transaction cost? And that, I think, is a real opportunity for Scottish agriculture and Scottish food and drink to excel more than we do elsewhere in the world. The final thing I say is about extracting value from other parts of the world as well. Certainly our experience in working with pigmeat processors across the UK to grow export markets for fifth quarter of the pig carcass, we've been able to not only increase the value back to the pig processing industry, but also back to producers as well, probably estimated £35 a pig in 10 years.
Okay, I think we're going to leave it there and move on to the next theme, which is, well, Jamie's going to tell us. Sorry, that's a smile. I cut across his bows last week, and it's my way of apologising. Jamie, your theme.
I think, actually, given the longevity of the first three themes, we've perhaps covered quite a bit of this, but I'd like to focus a bit on trade, if I may. And I don't mean just hypothesising what deals might or might not look like, but actually to look at some of the logistics around export and import deals. Just to set the scene from the evidence that we were given in writing, we export around £105 million of agricultural products to the EU, and I think there seems to be a general consensus among the written submissions that that we should protect as much of that as possible. But the other figures we were also presented are quite interesting, and that's that we export £245 million to the rest of the world and over £625 million to the rest of the UK as well. So there clearly is a huge export market, but there's also, on the other side of that, an import market too. So, being part of the EU at the moment naturally allows for importation from other EU countries, but also outside the EU there are certain lower zero tariff countries that we trade with too. So I guess I'm looking for some views from some of the witnesses on what they think an ideal solution might look like in a post-Brexit environment. For example, the SLE in their submission said that if we restrict exports but open up the import market, it could be devastating. The NFUS, on the other hand, said that we should be prioritising deals with certain target markets such as Canada, the US and the UAE. So I'm quite keen to hear us sort of develop that theme a little bit more.
Okay, what I'm going to do, because I think this is really to each of the witnesses, is to start off with you, Tom, and then work round. And if you don't want to say anything, that's fine. But if you want to add something in, please do, Tom, if you'd like to start.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we obviously have quite important interest in export markets, given the role that we play working with food companies, particularly in the meat sector, in developing market opportunities. I would, as a plug, I would, if anybody wants to know more about the trade opportunities and threats, the report that we produced back in September last year documents that across the whole of agriculture and horticulture in terms of the sort of key opportunities and threats. Undoubtedly, there are tremendous opportunities, and probably one of the biggest opportunities of moving out of the European Union, moving out of the customs union in particular, is the ability to establish and strike new trade opportunities with other third countries. And there are opportunities there, not only in the ones that are listed in the NFU Scotland paper, which are very true, but also big opportunities in China. We see that through the trade missions that we undertake to China, and also through the Agriculture Councillor post in Beijing that HDB funds. So we've been able to exploit and unlock those opportunities, and they are significant and tremendous. But we can't understate the importance not only of intra-UK trade to Scottish agriculture, but in particular, especially for the red meat sectors, the importance of EU trade. And in particular, when we see tariff levels of in excess of 50% for meat products, were we to face the situation of a cliff edge after 2019, with the risk of the prospect of paying the common external tariff to export sheep meat, of which 90% plus goes to the rest of the European Union, and of which the UK is the single biggest exporter in the European Union, the risks are cataclysmic for certain sectors of Scottish agriculture.
Andrew, would you like to build on that?
I'll keep it brief because Tom's touched on this great potential challenges, opportunities. I guess my point to add to that would just be trade's potentially the linchpin here. We've already talked about sort of our future agricultural policy and regulation and rolling out these things over, and UK framework or not, the degree to which there is trade or future trade deals could be really important and have an impact on those other things. So it kind of, these things could slot into place or could fall apart depending on the future of these relationships.
Jonnie.
I'll just add that since day one, since the outcome of the referendum, we've made it clear that, you know, our position has been we want to see continued unfettered free trade with both the EU and non-EU. We realise that that's become more and more difficult to attain, given that we're not going to be members of the single market and so on, or a customs union, and we're going to go through a process of negotiating free trade agreements. But even those free trade agreements, if they are true to what they say, should allow certainly agricultural produce, in our opinion, to be both tariff-free and distant, if you like, from other regulatory barriers that might be put in place. That's not just with the EU, but obviously all other EU, non-EU countries as well. And we refer to different potential export markets in our paper, as you referred to. I think obviously, a number of individuals over the last year or so, particularly in the referendum campaign, did make an issue about the fact that actually coming out of the EU would allow us, the UK to suck in cheap food imports, and that would be good for consumers. If you suck in imports of food, basically, yes, you're exporting the jobs and the incomes that are associated with farming and food processing. But probably more significantly, and I think this is an important point, you're also exporting the responsibility for animal health and welfare standards and exporting the environmental standards that we farm to within the United Kingdom and in Scotland. I think Stephen referred to the exceptionally high standards at which we operate, and nobody wants to see that roll back. And again, as I think Tom referred to, we as a Scottish agriculture will never compete on high, massive volume markets with very, very tight margins. We've got to maximise our value in terms of the provenance issue and the story behind the product in terms of the standards at which it's been produced and so on. So I think it's extremely dangerous for us to be contemplating anything that might threaten Scottish exports capacity, but equally we've got to work hard at creating new opportunities as we go forward.
Thank you, Johnny. I just keep looking at you, and that will come with consequences. Stuart, can I bring you in, and then Jamie? Can I? Stuart, can I?
I mean, there's not a great deal I can add from the forestry sector. Basically, we export very little of the production that we have outside the UK. A little bit more of panel board than there is of sawmill equipment material, but principally it's exported from Scotland to the rest of the UK. But it's a significant market. We produce far more than we consume in Scotland, so trade with the rest of the UK is the big issue for us.
Do you want to come in on?
I was very briefly just in response to your. I just wanted to, if you could clarify a point for me, just so we could understand some potential outcomes. In the written submission, it says that moving to an EEA or an EFTA model similar to that held by Norway would exclude most agricultural products. So.
Existing deal that Norway has.
Right, okay. So in that respect, given the, is your preference then for complete unfettered access to the, in the way that we currently have access to
that's,
the
That's been our preference from day one.
Okay, thanks for clarifying.
Yeah, there's a number of issues. I think you're right in the sense of UK is a net importer. We net import to the value of something like 20 billion. Our biggest trade partners are within the European Union, so Ireland and Netherlands. I think they're about 7 or 8 billion of our imports come from there. I'm sure they're not going to try and just cast us aside in any trade deals. So there's an awful lot to play here. There's member states with vested interests in making sure that they still have free access to the. To the UK market. How we get around that is an entirely different thing. We certainly won't be going into EFTA, an EFTA type approach or a EEA approach, given that we don't, or the UK government don't want to basically sign up to the four freedoms, particularly the freedom of movement of people. So that approach appears to be out, which means then we are negotiating our own deal and trying to negotiate free access to those things. If you look at QMS's figures, QMS estimate that about 10% of our red meat is in terms of exports, but it's a quarter of the sheep meat sector is exports, of which half of it goes to France and another 27% goes to the Benelux countries. So coming back to Tom's point, if we're faced with the tariffs that exist under sort of WTO rules, the sheep meat sector and the beef sector are in for a very, very torrid time in terms of that. And part of that is to do with the exchange rate as well. So there's a relatively small percentage tariff, but then there's quite a chunky euro per ton tariff that we have, and with the euro sterling rate the way it is just now, that means that tariff essentially has gone up quite significantly in the last while.
Okay, fine. And Pete, can I also, if you've got a short response on that as well?
Yeah, very short. Obviously, the Scottish sheep sector is a vanishingly small part of the UK economy and won't feature highly on the trade negotiations, but Tom's much better at me at saying it's potentially cataclysmic in terms of our landscape as well as our industry. So we have to be prepared for the worst, actually, as well as hoping for the best.
Okay. We'll move on to the next theme, if we may, which, Mari, you'll get. Sorry? I think, Stuart, I've got to move on to the next one. I'm going to move on to Mari. Mari, if you could move on to the next theme.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, the next theme is access to labour and scientific and research expertise. So it's really just to get your views on what the implications will be for labour in across agriculture and in forestry as well from leaving the EU.
Okay, Stuart, would you like to start on that, please?
Yes, I can do. In forestry, we do use both seasonal labour and migrant labour. Seasonal labour is primarily when we're establishing new forests. So it's something we do in wintertime. It's a seasonal activity, and it involves people planting, fencing, and it's an activity driven by grant, which has been very much going like this, you know, up and down for some time. So everybody working in that sector has built businesses based around having flexibility with labour. We also have a lot of migrant labour in harvesting. Because we're now harvesting an awful lot more forestry than we have in the past, we haven't organically grown the same amount of Scottish-based harvester operators, and therefore we have relied on bringing people in from overseas. At the moment, we're already seeing some impact on that because they're working here in order to send money back, and if sterling's 17-18% stronger than it was, then the 17-18% weaker than it was, the 17-18% less money to go back. So we're already starting to see some impacts. So what we are keen to see is that whatever form it takes in the future, there is a need for the forestry sector to be included in any seasonal or migrant labour scheme that we put in. There will be needs, and we're expecting forestry activity to be increasing in coming years. In terms of research, forest research, so the Forestry Commission's research agency does access significant sums of money, hundreds of thousands of pounds every year in EU cooperative projects. And as a sector which is relatively immature, we're operating on 40-year cycles. We've grown hugely over the last 30 years. So as a sector, we're still relatively immature in terms of our understanding forestry practices, how we can breed trees, how we can be more successful, how we can deliver more for the environment. Having the opportunity and access to common research programs is important. So there's a big issue there about access to these EU-wide projects as well as the funding themselves.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Stephen, do you want to add anything to that? I would ask you to be brief, if possible.
I'll be as brief as possible. Yeah, just a matter of interest, the Scottish Government have just issued a call for a study into migrant labour in agriculture just recently, just the last couple of days. So they're undertaking some work on that. What we have to remember is that, again, going back to the Rural Scotland Focus report, I pulled out some statistics for that, and I was flabbergasted that there was 500,000 work hours from migrant labour. I put a figure in of 2,500 FTEs. Of course, they're not working full-time, so if you make that into 2 months a year or 1 month a year, multiply it by 10 or 9 or whatever, it's quite a lot of people. But we forget that that's just in agriculture, in the processing sector. We're pretty heavily reliant on foreign labour in terms of the meat processing sector. In terms of research, access to EU funds is incredibly important. Horizon 2020, the old framework, the old framework programmes, they add significant value to our knowledge base. Within the sort of the main research providers in terms of agriculture and food and environment, there's quite a lot of foreign or overseas researchers. We have got an incredible knowledge base built on migrants, people that have relocated to Scotland in terms of their expertise. So yeah, the accessing that EU funding base is incredibly important, but also accessing the skill base in terms of their research knowledge.
Pete, do you want to come in just on? Okay, I mean it's pretty much coming to the opinion of how important they are. Tom, would you like to come
in? Just to perhaps provide some numbers to give some context around labour. Of the according to the ONS, 2015, there were 22,517 EU nationals employed permanently in UK agriculture and horticulture. And given there are about 115,000 full-time employees in the industry across the UK, it's probably not unreasonable to assume that 20% of them are therefore EU nationals. But that probably masks the scale of the importance of the horticulture, fresh produce sector in particular, where there's a much greater demand for seasonal labour, and it's probably not unreasonable to assume that somewhere between 50 and 90% of the workforce in the fresh produce sector, particularly in packhouses and in Pekin, are other EU nationals. Food manufacturing, 38% of the workforce are migrants as terms. So the issue is particularly significant for the food manufacturing sector, and therefore the uncertainty around the availability and access to labour will have an impact on the kind of decisions that companies make going forward.
Okay, Andrew, that's pretty comprehensive. Do you want to add to that?
Only briefly, in terms of migrant labour is important, but then the question is, well, what do you do about it? So there's certainty required, but then there's also previously seasonal worker schemes had existed but were stopped when freedom of movement restrictions were removed. So there's potential to recreate mechanisms that provide migrant labour, but those need to be developed moving forward.
Okay, Jonnie, do you want to?
Yeah, I think there's six key strands to labour issues that, I mean, they are vitally, vitally important to Scottish agriculture, but not just agriculture on its own, the whole food processing and the supply chain. There's the seasonal and the permanent, there's the on-farm, the off-farm, and there's the skilled and the unskilled. And I think we need to make sure we cover each and every element of that. At any one time in Scotland, there are about 15,000 seasonal workers in Scotland in any year. And within our agriculture and food processing sectors, about 8,000 full-time equivalents. And particularly in sectors like red meat, in abattoirs and cutting plants, the role of that labour is really important. But the skill levels are also very important to remember as well. We're looking at an awful lot of veterinary services in Scotland are provided by European vets. And I think we cannot overestimate how important they are to making sure that the wheels, if you like, of agriculture keep on turning. I think one of the big questions, I think, is every conversation we've had with the UK government about this has been that the issue was all about free movement of people. But now they're talking about controlled movement of people. But what we can't get out of UK government is an answer as to what does controlled movement mean? And it then goes back to things that Andrew's just raised. That we used to have the seasonal agriculture workers scheme, SOARS, which obviously is about temporary work, but what about those who are already here, permanent employees and so on? So we need some questions pretty quickly from the Home Office in particular, and we do keep writing to Amber Rudd, but she doesn't seem to respond. So we need some answers, I think, from the Home Office about those sorts of things. Can I just finish on the research issue? The research issue is essential as well. The funding for research clearly is the underpinning of innovation, and a lot of comments have been made about the need for innovation. If we don't have the drive in research that we have had for many, many years in Scotland, that then Scottish agriculture can then utilise in changed practice and utilising new technology and so on, then we will never be able to compete. So the research investment is just as important as the on-farm investment in making sure that the agricultural industry keeps moving forward.
I can let you come back very briefly, maybe to make a comment.
Yeah, it was just a quick supplementary to that, because obviously it's an area which is vital for my constituency, and also into Angus South as well, Graham Day's area, where there's a lot of soft fruit production, and obviously EU migrant labour is particularly important there. But it was just to see, I mean, I even met with a business last week who are already are closing down part of their business because of the uncertainty over the access to EU migrant labour. Are you seeing impacts elsewhere across the sector already with that uncertainty and that situation being
Can I just come in there?
No, sorry. You've had quite an input at the moment. Can we please go to Stephen to come back?
I was just wanting to make a point of clarification from Stuart Stevenson. In terms of the Netherlands, I should have made it clear that it acts as a major hub in terms of imports coming into the EU, which then come into the UK. So it is it acts as that hub. So not all that product is from the Netherlands, but it's still of vital importance in terms of that.
And I'm sure he could have made that point in the 12 words he said he would. and that is duly noted as well. Sorry, can I go to Tom at the end, please?
I think it's difficult. Probably Jonnie would have a better sense from his members about where the businesses are seeing a practical impact. I'm certainly aware of an impact in the short term, but some of that's related to exchange rates and, of course, the salary differential that the worker seeing in the short term. I think, look, Andrew's right. We do need to look to the future and not just talk about the risks and the threat. What are the potential solutions? We've already had the solution flagged around looking at controlled migration and some kind of both seasonal and permanent worker scheme. That will impose some capacity challenges on the Home Office, but that's quite important, and the case has been made by the farming unions. There is an opportunity to improve labour productivity. Labour productivity in agriculture isn't as high as some other industries, so what can we do to improve skills and training of the workforce that might improve productivity? Increasing automation, that goes back to the point about investing in innovation. What can we do to actually reduce long-term dependency by increasing automation through both farming and the supply chain? And then finally, what can you do to actually get more of the underutilised or unemployed in the UK into the workforce?
I'm afraid we're going to have to move on to the next theme, which is theme number 6.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I think we can probably go through this fairly quickly because I think we have already touched on it, but it's about the regulations and standards. In other words, red tape. And some regulations are international agreements, but many of them do come from the EU. And the Brian Pack, the red tape review, has already been mentioned by Stephen, and there's a quote from Brian, and he said, "There must be an easier, more efficient, less costly way to regulate Scottish farming and land management." And I think we could all agree with that. But is it really practical? And will leaving the EU enable a change in industry standards? And we have touched on this, so we might be able to move fairly quickly.
Okay. Andrew, do you want to start on that?
Thank you, convener. Yes, in the longer term, potentially. Yes, sorry. In the longer term, yes. I think you know, as I said earlier, our broad position is that actually we need to acknowledge the challenge of changing from one regime to another, and that creates a really quite significant sort of capacity problem. So our approach is that we take a sort of phased or transitional approach to regulation as well as future policy, so that we kind of roll over where we are and then look at what we can change. There are limits to that, though, unfortunately, and those will be related to trade. So in order to be able to trade, then ultimately we probably need to be able to satisfy the requirements of trading partners. And so if, given that our biggest trading partner outside the UK is the EU, we'll probably end up having to do something similar, as long as it meets their requirements. There has to be opportunity in there to be able to still meet their broad requirements without having to follow the letter of their rules. And I think that's where the opportunities will lie.
Bring in Mike, and then if I may, bring in Pete.
Yes, by that response, because reading the question, will leaving the EU enable a change in industry standards? In other words, the implication is, with the red tape, that we're able to drop standards. Surely we can't drop standards if we're aiming to maintain our market share in the rest of the European Union. Surely, if anything, it may be quite the reverse. We're trying to get into other areas where we have to maintain and improve these standards. So it could actually reduce, far from reduce red tape, it could actually increase it. I don't quite understand how we could be in the business of reducing red tape.
Okay, can I bring in Pete, and then I'll come to Jonnie with a...
Yeah, I think I just want to make it clear on behalf of Environment Link that, you know, we think the EU environmental acquis has been entirely or almost entirely progressive. It's helped us in the UK have cleaner water and cleaner air and protected species. It's been a good thing. So we certainly don't see it as Environment Link. Can't wait till the EU stops and we can get off the bus. We want to stay on that bus and we want our regulations, not always slavishly to follow things, but basically to follow that process of better regulation, but raising standards. We also believe that improved regulation or tighter regulation, if you like, regulatory stringency, drives technical efficiency. You only have to look at the building industry to see how much better our buildings are. And they're not better because builders are better people than farmers. They're better because regulations drove efficiency in our buildings. So better regulation drives efficiency. So we don't think that regulation equals red tape, quite the contrary.
Okay, Johnny, do you want to come in on that?
I tend to echo that point that Pete's just made. I mean, we're not in the business of trying to bring the standard down. Absolutely not. We must be seen and must be clear that we are meeting standards in all sorts of aspects. But we definitely have an opportunity of coming out of the EU, of unpicking some of the bureaucratic issues that are not fit for purpose, and I think Stephen referred to them earlier on, which aren't adding to the standard, but they are adding to complication and compliance risk and therefore ultimately to business cost, but not adding anything in terms of value from the public interest. And I think there's a whole range of those, certainly riddled throughout the CAP regulations in terms of validation, verification, audit, inspection, and all the rest of it, but also in lots of other spheres that we touched on in terms of various directives. We're definitely not in the business of wanting to erode standards or reduce standards at all. That would be to our detriment. We need to be seen and be clear that we're producing the very high standards, the highest standards, in order to capture markets. But at the same time, we can unpick some things which just really don't add value at all, but we have to comply with because we are part of the EU currently.
Tom, you wanted to come in.
Just very, very, very quickly, convener. We probably should distinguish between red tape regulation and standards. The first point. The second point is when we look into the future. Not only do we have the capacity challenge that we highlighted earlier from a regulatory perspective, but if we want to be able to access and open up new market opportunities overseas in places like China, like the US, then it will be important that we can demonstrate the high quality, traceability, safety, integrity of the products that we provide. And it does strike me that we're likely to continue to want to trade off the back of having high standards as opposed to low standards. That, of course, in terms of looking at the separation of red tape, that doesn't mean to say there isn't the opportunity to make things a bit simpler and a bit easier for people.
Okay, I think I'm going to leave that there because there seems to be a general theme across this about not letting standards.
Who feel that there are red tape regulations, because I don't know what they are, could they like to the convener to a list of things that you think is the red tape?
I think it would be helpful to have some examples of red tape if that's possible. Peter.
To what Mike's saying, I mean, the absolute thing we need to look at is Brian Pack's report, which came out, what, a year, 18 months ago, and he identified many, many areas where we could cut back on red tape, and that's the document that we should be looking at, and that's a document that I hope the Scottish Government is looking at, because there are issues there that should be addressed, as Johnny says, that don't add anything, they just add grief and grievance and the paperwork for the farming industry we can do without.
I'm sure the clerks will direct the committee to where to find that report. Stephen, you want to come in very briefly, but it must be very briefly.
Very briefly. On the PAC report, I've got hard copies I can give people if they want a hard copy. On that point of the regulatory burden, on the external trade, we may actually see regulations increase because you have to deal with rules of origin, you have to deal with new labelling requirements, so it's not all about the existing. Within the existing, there's some crazy rules regarding mapping that we might be able to drop. Particularly, I always remember when we were doing the review that you're looking for something half the size of a tennis court in the largest field in Scotland is 44,000 hectares. And you're looking for combined features that add up to half the size of a tennis court. That's where it's ridiculous. And if we can drop them, that's good.
The deputy convener now wants to go on with the next theme.
Yeah, Pete will be delighted to know it's about integrated land use policy. So Scottish Land Estates, Confor, I mean, you've all mentioned it in your written submissions. I'm just going to let Pete talk.
Very briefly, Will, I think it's obviously it's in our submission, and I think there's going to be much dissent here about the fact that we are building on an existing land use strategy, the Land Reform Act, a framework for land use in Scotland, which I think we can take credit for the fact that people are getting together and talking about that. I think our concern is that at the moment we've got sort of fairly high-level principles in terms of land use strategy. It would be helpful to try and bring that down more into a regional level and to improve the governance of that so that more different actors are involved in that, but that we can and must find ways of using our land to produce multiple objectives. Everybody said that. We have got a climate change imperative, and I pick up Stuart's point about the way that the cap actually disincentivizes tree planting where it would be very sensible to do that. And I think a regional land use framework, or even looking at things at a catchment level, can allow not just landowners, land managers, the environment agencies, government, but also communities to have some say in what are our priorities locally, what can we do to this, and to actually engage communities in that conversation rather than as can happen in parts of Scotland. People feel the forest came in and they displaced the farms and isn't that terrible, but actually saying how can, as Stuart says, we get some benefit out of that for everybody? How can we plan that so that the communities gain, houses can get built, the whole thing can improve rather than land use decisions are just made by people and then everybody else has to live with it. So an integrated framework seems sensible to us.
So the next logical person to come to is Stuart to talk about how he can integrate forestry within the agricultural schemes and how, because I'm sure you'll have views on how integration with livestock could work, but is currently restricted.
Yes, thank you, convener. Looking at or sort of reflecting back, as you say in our submission, we just feel that the existence of the Common Agricultural Policy just basically sucks all the oxygen out of the room. We talk to politicians, we talk to civil servants, we talk to commentators, and over the last 20 years, everybody, even though forestry was included in 1992 as an activity, everybody thinks about agriculture. Everybody thinks about how do we make agricultural systems work? How do we get the payments out? How do we structure everything around agriculture? And it just doesn't leave any opportunity for thought time and activity to be saying, step back, how do we actually have successful rural areas? Because agriculture may have been the dominant part of rural communities in the beginning of the 20th century, but it's not the beginning of the 21st century. So we do need to look at how we have successful green rural areas. And we would put forward the opportunities we were starting to see emerge, and you mentioned the ability to integrate forestry within livestock. And it's a great frustration for us that there are actually very few farmers, land managers out there who are looking at how they could plant trees on part of the land and then reap the benefits in terms of shelter for sheep, so the sheep need to eat less food, the better quality. The reduction in sheep production or meat production is in most cases that we've seen is nil, or in actual fact there's higher quality of production. And then you have on that land the opportunity to convert to something which doesn't require a long-term subsidy, which is providing environmental benefits, which is providing climate change benefits, it's mitigating flooding, and it's providing an economic activity to support rural businesses. So what we really want is the opportunity, as we move forward, as Scottish Government, this committee, sending a signal to everybody thinking about commenting on rural policy, to look at the civil servants within Scottish Government to say, don't just be thinking about agricultural policy and how we roll it forward. let's have some cross-thinking between forestry, civil servants, between agricultural civil servants, environmental civil servants, about how we can have a framework for policy in Scotland which will allow us to take and transition from an agricultural policy, as I was saying earlier, to what we see as a countryside policy.
Okay. Andrew, you wanted to come in.
Echo those comments, really. The land delivers a whole range of things, and to a certain extent, policy determines land use significantly by the amount of money that's provided through things like the Common Agricultural Policy. And sometimes that can be a barrier to the sort of maximising the output. So it really focuses on producing one output, because that's what we as a society decided. Actually, we really need some food right now, so we designed a policy to maximise that if we could, or to support farming. And so policy really drives the degree to which, or the way in which the land is used. And so there's an opportunity to reframe it, and it's a once-in-a-generation, once-in-a 40-year opportunity to do that. But it's not in any way easy, and there are some real challenges, and Pete picked up on one of them, and there's a governance challenge. So at the moment, the way that things tend to work is through those different sectors. So the farm sector gets, has policy, and forestry has its policy, and they've kind of come together a little bit in the way that forestry had to be brought within the rural development program. But there's a very much a sectoral approach, and rural development is kind of, again, seen as separate. But if you're talking about integrated land use, how do you deliver that? And Pete started talking about sort of a regional approach. That raises really quite significant problems for how the Scottish government sort of develops. How do you go from developing a national policy, which you hope is sort of delivering integrated land use, to enabling it to be developed through a regional approach where you might have greater participation at that regional level? So you go from silos into regions, and that's an issue. It was tried relatively recently to a degree through the previous SRDP, where regional priorities were created as a mechanism to try and identify what priorities were in different places. And it actually didn't work that well. And so there are some real challenges in how it's delivered. And I think we need to sort of come together to assess the mechanisms through which we could take that forward.
So simple scoring might not work. Jonnie, do you want to come in there?
Yeah, I mean, I certainly support the principles and always have done of integrated land use, but I think we need to be careful about the scale. The principles are spot on, as I say, but if you take it down to the individual hectare or even the individual business, it's almost impossible to do all things all the time to have any optimal or reasonable outcome. There are trade-offs. There's an opportunity cost of what you do with your land, because as soon as you plant it under trees, you can't then use it for food production or renewables or recreation or whatever it might be. But if we take a step back and actually look at it more of a landscape scale or a catchment scale and integrate things like flood risk management and all the other things, then I think we really can talk here. Just to make a point about Stuart's observations about upland sheep management in trees, just for the record, the NFU Scotland are 100% supportive of that sort of initiative. But there are challenges there, and the challenges aren't about the objectives of the farmer. In many senses, there are the issues around many, many hill farms being tenanted, and it's not the farmer's choice as to whether he can plant trees or not. That's within the gift of the landowner, and therefore there are other issues there. So as a principle, yes, but I think we need to be very, very careful about what we do expect from every hectare of land. But I would take up Pete's point, and I think it's an important one. There are certain areas that you could certainly look and say, what are the priorities that we want to try and achieve here? And if we've got prime agricultural land in Scotland, and we haven't got much of it, let's make sure that its prime use is agricultural. And then in other parts of Scotland, where agricultural values become more marginal, let's look at other alternative uses, if that might be the case. And I would say that largely happens by the drivers of the market of the markets as much as anything else. Yes, they have been stifled to a degree by where support payments go, and that's created inertia. But going forward, under a new policy settlement, that inertia might be broken down, because it won't just be about occupation of land to get an agricultural support payment. It will be about activity on the land to to get a support payment. And that's the principle we should be going for.
Okay, Gail, do you want to follow up?
Just really quickly, and this answer could be one or two words, are there any countries where it's currently working?
A regional...
Just an integrated land use policy.
Sorry?
They operate under...
Finland?
Finland, Sweden.
Okay, maybe that's an area to look at.
Thanks.
I'm afraid I've got to move on to the next point, which will be introduced by Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. Tom talked about opportunities that come in developing markets in China, and Andrew talked about opportunities that come from the change that we're facing as well. And I'd just like to give perhaps initially others the opportunity to bring forward any opportunities that we have that come from the change from our no longer being in the EU.
Who'd like to lead on that? Andrew, would you like to?
I guess the biggest one from our perspective is actually what we've been talking about already, which is the opportunity to redesign policy in such a way that suits us. The step of leaving the EU potentially creates those opportunities in terms of regulation, in terms of more targeted support, potentially integrated land management. The opportunity is great because we could potentially, you know, redesign policy that really delivers for Scottish land managers, but for Scotland as a whole. The challenge is also great in doing that, but it's there if you want to grab it.
Sorry, I'm going to challenge you slightly. Turn that into something specific that I can actually touch, feel, and think about. You know, what would be the first thing you would do, given that opportunity?
Okay. Well, we have to, given the previous arguments, we have to acknowledge that we need to avoid a cliff edge. So we're not talking about just turning a switch from one thing mm-hmm. to another. Mm-hmm. So we have to be on that trajectory, where we change policy. For example, at the moment, we have a structure of support where the majority of support that goes to farmers goes through direct support with a smaller proportion to rural development, agri-environment, and so on. You know, there's an opportunity to rethink that structure, so we don't necessarily need to have pillars in support. We could change the way that we deliver that. We could change the degree to which we provide direct support. You could provide a base level of support, which is a safety net, but then put a greater level of support to enhancing the industry's productivity and profitability. We could focus much more on the sort of agri-environment public goods, so you could put a greater proportion at least of the budget towards that. We could provide a great deal of certainty to the forestry to the forestry industry so that they have the stability that they need. So the opportunities there are great. You know, those are the things we have to decide on.
Tom, would you like to?
I guess I've already covered off in a sense this. The key opportunities that we'd see are in a sense the opportunities to be able to go out there and develop new trading arrangements in a much more fleet of foot fashion than perhaps the European Union has been able to do. It's taken 7 years to conclude negotiations on CETA, the Canadian trade agreement. It's not exactly a complete free trade agreement, but it's taken a long time to do it. So there's a potential with the right resources and the right will and skill for us to be able to do that. The question is, do we have the resources, the will and skill, and also what are the trade-offs? For example, if we do kind of go out there blindly seeking a trade agreement with the United States, what are the potential consequences? There are some probably upside risks, but also downside risks as well. So the big opportunity really for us is in being able to kind of go out there and develop new markets for British agriculture, horticulture, and specifically for Scottish products.
Pete, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, just to say, I think the big opportunity is, as Andy says, it's to open up the debate. We've got a not a clean bit of paper, we've got a fresh start we can make. So involving the widest set of possible people in that debate is really important. There's lots of things that we would want to see as link that we could do within the CAP. Integrated land use management is not prohibited from doing that by the CAP.
moving towards agroecology. We've argued for that. The cap allows us to do that in the way that France has done that. So the cap hasn't stopped us doing that. But having, if you like, control over the resource and the structures that we put into place opens up a public debate. There's also the possibility, which we floated, that some of the money that we come put into agriculture could actually be used to support nutrition for people on low incomes. 80% of the US food farm bill doesn't go to farmers, it goes to cities to support people on low incomes. Now, we may not want food stamps or anything like it, but you know, it does open up those possibilities of thinking again about how do you support farming, maybe support farming by subsidising consumers to buy veg from Scottish farms rather than the other way around.
Stephen.
On the trade, there's obviously opportunities there. We've got a very strong brand in whisky. Salmon's got a very good reputation. Scotland's seen as pretty organic, if even though it's not organic, natural. So we've got an opportunity to trade on that. The problem we have with trade deals is that you can't just cherry pick parts of your sector or your economy. You have to pretty much go with all your trade to America, or you can't just say, let's go with on a beef trade deal. We can't just do that. So there are opportunities, but there's real challenges within that. Within the wider policy sphere, we know that farmers and land managers are very quick to react to proper incentives. All you need to do is look at the renewable energy and how successful that has been in terms of changing our landscape. If the right incentives there, you can get land management change. On the market driving change, we've seen that happening, and we're seeing it happening in the beef sector with the penalties on heavy animals going into abattoirs. So if the signals are right, whether they're policy or market, we can actually drive change in agriculture and land management. Those are the kind of opportunities, thinking smartly how we incentivise things and getting the market signals right.
Stuart, would you like to add anything to what's been said, or do you think it's coming? Okay, and Johnny, signals from the market will make changes?
Signals from the market, yes, and other people have covered some of those opportunities. I think we have a very, very quick opportunity by withdrawing from the CAP, we could finally break this hoodoo, if you like, of spending lots and lots of money on relatively empty or completely empty hillsides. And we could focus our support payments on activity. And that is going to be critical going forward. If we have less budget to play with, then hitting the target becomes absolutely vital. And we as an organization do not want to see money going to those who simply occupy land rather than manage the land, take risk on the land, and try and generate a reward from the land. So I think we have a clear opportunity in that sense that we could recast the activity requirements which we currently have to live with, which are a European construction, and make the focus of support spending in the future, no matter what the activity, but the activity gets it rather than the inactivity.
Okay. Stephen.
Just picking up at Johnny's point, it's a European requirement, the activity, which relates to, and their condition relates to the agreement on agriculture. So trade deal in terms of WTO is important because we can't just go down the activity rule under their rules. We have to be really careful. I agree with you, it's important that we only support active people, but we have to be careful in how we do it.
I'm going to let Tom come in,
it's about if John is fully aware of blue box, green box, and amber box rules, then. There is an issue in terms of green
now,
box.
Now we get into the debate. I'm sorry, we have come to the end of this session. I think we've had a wide-ranging discussion, and I thank everyone for their input. I think if there's anything as a result of this session that anyone feels that they haven't had the chance to raise, which I'd be disappointed if there wasn't much that there was much that you felt you hadn't had the chance to raise, I would ask you to write into the committee and to let us know your views if there are specific areas. But on behalf of the committee, I'd like you to thank you all for your attendance today. And I'm briefly going to suspend the meeting now to allow you to leave the room. Thank you very much. The second item on the agenda is subordinate legislation, and it's a negative instrument as detailed on the agenda. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on that, on that instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. There have also been no representations to the committee from any outside agency. Does any member of the committee wish to make comment on the instrument? Is the committee therefore agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to this instrument? That is therefore agreed. That concludes today's meeting, ladies and gentlemen, and I would just like to talk very briefly to the committee now that meeting is concluded.